One day, early in this journey, it dawned on me that the way I've been running Interface is the way of the plunderer. Plundering something that's not mine, something that belongs to every creature on earth. And I said to myself, my goodness, the day must come, and this is illegal, that when plundering is not allowed, I mean, it must come. So I said to myself, my goodness, someday people like me will end up in jail.
I've got to be honest with you. When the September 11th situation happened, I didn't know that. And I must say, I want to say this because it's, I want to take it lightly. It's not a light situation. It's a devastating act. It was really a bad thing. It was the worst things I've seen in my lifetime, you know. But I will tell you, and every trader will tell you, who was not in that building and who was buying gold and who owned gold and silver, that when it happened, the first thing you thought about was, well, how much is gold up? The first thing that came to mind was, my God, gold must be exploding. Fortunately for us, all our clients were in gold. So when it went up, they all doubled their money. Everybody doubled their money. It was a blessing in disguise. Devastating, crushing, heart-shattering, but on a financial sense. For the, my clients that were in the market, they all made money. Now, I wasn't looking for this type of help. But it happened. When the U.S. bombed Iraq, back in 1991, the price of oil went from $13 to $40 a barrel, for Christ's sake. Now, we couldn't wait for the bombs to start raining down on Saddam Hussein. We were all excited. We wanted Saddam to really create problems. Do whatever you have to do. Set fire to some more oil wells because the price is going to go higher. Every broker was chanting that. There was not a broker that I know of that wasn't excited about that. This was a disaster. This was something that was, you know, catastrophe happening, bombing, wars. In devastation, there is opportunity.
The pursuit of profit is an old story, but there was a time when many things were regarded either as too sacred or too essential for the public good to be considered business opportunities. They were protected by tradition and public regulation.
We can really begin to take a look at the emergence of the modern age with the enclosure movements of the great European commons in the 14th, 15th, and 16th century. Medieval life was a collectively lived life. It was a brutish, nasty affair, but there was a collective responsibility. People belonged to the land did not belong to people. And in this European world, people farmed the land in a collective way because they saw it as a commons. It belonged to God. And then it was administered by the church, the aristocracy, and then the local manors as stewards of God's creation. Beginning with Tudor England, we began to see a phenomenon emerge, and that is the enclosure of the great commons by parliamentary acts in England and then in Europe. And so first we began to take the great land masses of the world, which were commons and shared, and we reduced those to private property. Then we went after the oceans, the great oceanic commons, and we created laws and regulations that would allow countries to claim a certain amount of water outside their coastal limits for exploitation. In this century, we went after the air, and we divided it into air corridors that could be bought and sold for commercial traffic for airplanes. And then, of course, the rest is history.
With deregulation, privatization, free trade, what we're seeing is yet another enclosure and, if you like, private taking of the commons. One of the things I find very interesting in our current debates is this concept of who creates wealth. that wealth is only created when it's owned privately. What would you call clean water, fresh air, a safe environment? Are they not a form of wealth? And why does it only become wealth when some entity puts a fence around it and declares it private property? Well, you know, that's not wealth creation, that's wealth usurpation.
Over the centuries, we have put more and more things in that public realm, and lately, just lately, in the last, let's say, 3 or 4 decades, started pulling them out again. So, firefighters, for instance.
This man leads the fire department.
Firefighters started as private companies.
Yes, and lots of other people need the fire department too.
And if you didn't have the medallion of a given firefighter brigade on your house and it was on fire, those firefighters would just, you know, ride on by because you didn't have a deal. Well, we gradually evolved a public trust for the provision of safety on that very specific level. This is important. We should not go back from that and start saying, well, you know, why don't we put that back in the market and see what that does? Maybe it'll make it more efficient.
The privatization does not mean you take a public institution and give it to some nice person. It means you take a public institution and give it to an unaccountable tyranny. Public institutions have many side benefits. For one thing, they may purposely run at a loss. They're not out for profit. They may purposely run at a loss because of the side benefits. So, for example, if a public steel industry runs at a loss, it's providing cheap steel to other industries. Maybe that's a good thing. Public institutions can have a countercyclic property. So that means that they can maintain employment in periods of recession, which increases demand, which helps you get out of a recession. A private company can't do that in a recession throughout the workforce. That's the way you make money.
There are those who intend that one day everything will be owned by somebody. And we're not just talking goods here, we're talking human rights, human services, essential services for life, education, public health, social assistance, pensions, housing. We're also talking about the survival of the planet, the areas that we believe must be maintained in the commons or under common control, or we will collectively die, water and air.
Even in the case of air, there's been some progress. And here the idea is to say, look, we can't avoid the dumping of carbon dioxide. We can't avoid the dumping of sulfur oxides. At least we can't at the moment afford to stop doing that. So we're dumping a certain amount of stuff into the environment. So we're going to say, with the current tonnage of sulfur oxides, for example, we will say that is the limit, and we'll create permits for that amount, give them to the people who have been doing the polluting, and now we will permit them to be traded. And so now, there's a price attached to polluting the environment. Now, wouldn't it be marvelous if we had one of those prices for everything?
It sounds like you're advocating private ownership of every square inch of the planet.
Absolutely.
Every cubic foot of air, water.
It sounds outlandish to say we want to have the whole universe, the whole of the Earth, owned. That doesn't mean I want to have Joe Bloggs owning this square foot, but it means that the interests that are involved in that stream are owned by some group or by some people who have an interest in maintaining them. And that, you know, that is not such a loony idea. So it's in fact the solution to a lot of these problems.